you got a point. And I went out to ask them. So I started with AS1 and worked my way through to AS, I guess, 3D8 or so, which I was did not have the luck as they still needed it. And then came across this one. Okay, 248. No, 248, sounds great. I had a look at the clock and decided that it's a good time to call there. It was in the US, and asked him about this particular object. Well, do you need this AS number? I mean, do you know what I'm talking about, this AS number you're having in this database? Oh, yeah, that's quite some time ago. It was in the 80s. Yeah, I was in Germany, and I was working for, have a look for yourself. And I said, well, do you just need that one, or do you need all four? Which is a question I instinctively replied with, yes, sure. And I did not believe it because, well, okay, he's obviously not sure what he's having there, but he promised me to forward me the email from RIPE NCC to recover the assets and was generally fine with it. Now, this is the email I got on that very day, with the passwords for all the four AS numbers or the maintainers on these. Now you may ask if that's a bad thing, because current policy says that every resource has to be allocated for a certain purpose and a certain person, but once that changes, it has to be re-evaluated and it's no longer valid practically. It's a policy the community has come up with, and serves the purpose. But these objects particularly are pre-RIPE, so they are not governed by the policy, and a recent policy decision in the last minute, they decided somehow that, these objects better be not part of any policy still. So not to change that policy, that these pre-policy objects are, that's bureaucratic. Obviously, that was rather easy. So there were also some other objects I was having a look at, and I recalled maintainer objects I still had the passwords for, because, well, people did not change anything, and I was always tempted to take certain large address blocks when some years ago a phenomenon started that really startled me. Somebody else was having a look at these objects and were subtly changing it. We're changing small pieces of it, I will show you later. And over the years, these objects mutated to something entirely different, used by somebody entirely different, protected by maintainers that were quite new. And one of these cases is a company that has their headquarters in some Bavarian village next to where I used to live a few years ago. So this totally made no sense that they had a number of /16s. It's not all in that object. They have some more assets. This is one of the I frequently make database snapshots to monitor such activity, and this is one of the earliest. It's American Express Europe Limited. Okay, well, they have a /16. It's a bank. That's okay. And it's protected by the RIPE NCC non-maintainer, which was introduced to solve the problem that some people have chosen to just say auth none, which is not so good a thing. So this object was basically protected. So somebody who had to apply for it had to, beyond reasonable doubt, certify that he is American Express Europe Limited. And somebody chose to do so. And I still am not really sure how they did it, but judging from the objects, they simply impersonated these corporations, as nobody cared, as in some cases the corporation even doesn't exist any longer. So they basically committed a crime there, which I luckily didn't, and it took me a while to also distinguish this. And In the meanwhile, these objects were mutating even further from American Express Europe Limited to AEE Europe Limited, which I found in the company's register, and it has been registered 2003. So if you have a look at the change history, they just did it. Yeah, they seemingly had some time. So they did not make all the changes at once, but over the last years, knowing that this asset is a very, very expensive one in like 10 years or so, when there are no IPv4 addresses anymore. They sit on a stockpile of pre-owned resources. However, yeah. Yeah, you can have a look for yourself. The maintainers mp-mnt. I've done so far. This is a particularly interesting set. For they do have their backbone network, which used to be an engineering GmbH, which is no longer existing. It's an old German postal code. Over here, oh, they still do exist. The Bayerische Landesanstalt für Aufbaufinanzierung is now System 4. Whatever. So, that's one of the domains they use. One of the in the past, when checks were not that easy to circumvent, it or for some objects, it was enough that you had the right email address. So, for example, if you find an object in the database which points to an email address that points to a domain which is no longer existent, you can register that domain and let them send you the stuff. And hopefully it's not that easy like this anymore, so I feel quite okay about talking about it, as the major problems luckily have been solved. So yeah. And you will find IP addresses that belong to IGEPA, which is a paper company. So IGRZ may be related to their data center or something like that. Yeah, that's about it. So I would like to go over to the question section, because I guess there will be quite a number of these. Yeah, hit me.
So if you have a question, please line up here behind the microphone.
Hallo.
Test. Did you inform the RIPE NCC about this? And if yes, what did they say?
The problem is that informing RIPE NCC about it doesn't cut it, as they just do what the community tells them. I frequently speak with members of this community. I myself am attending occasionally RIPE meetings. And it's really indeed a problem of the awareness of the people that can actually change a policy to preventing things like this. So imagine you have to convince people who do work for major carriers, for whomever you like, which represent their RIPE member at the RIPE meetings, and they do have to tell RIPE what to do. As RIPE NCC, the people who sit in Amsterdam, they are not in charge of deciding. They just have to adhere to the policy.
That's true, but it would be pretty trivial to just put up a vote at the next RIPE meeting, at the general meetings, which happens twice a year. Mm-hmm. And I'm pretty certain that every member would vote against these practices.
Well, the question is how to change these without...